Charles. While Janet Maracal, a Rockport, Indiana teenager, wants to play touch football with the Kennedys. Even if you have a famous name you fantasize, here's a fantasy about Jerry West, the former Laker. It's from a viewer named Jerry West from Wabash, Indiana, who's not a former pro. Lots of famous names live in Indiana. His fantasy, to meet Eric Dickerson of the Rams. His name, Eric Dickerson of Indianapolis, who thinks he even looks like his famous namesake. And a Fort Lauderdale woman has the right name. Her fantasy, to be a cheerleader before, as she puts it, the old body gives out. Her name, Mae Strutt. Sis, boom, ba. John Cross Jr. of San Diego says he has a famous face. He says he looks like Larry Bird and wants to play with him. Funny, Scott Ramey of Reno says he looks like Larry Bird. And Tom McDonough of Cranston, Rhode Island says he looks like Bird. He really does. Maybe that explains his license plate. You can always fantasize about a famous face if you don't have one. Pennsylvania's Todd Orsich fantasizes about golfer Jan Stevenson. He wants one of her calendars autographed. And Todd, here's your personally autographed Jan Stevenson calendar. She writes, Todd, come play around with me. Juliet Greer of Dallas wanted to display her body on Sports Fantasy. She wants to be the round girl in a heavyweight fight. Emmett Bryson Simmons III of Los Angeles just wanted to display his face at every major sports event on television, saying, hi, Mom. While Colorado's Bob Meldrum simply wanted his face displayed on a Wheaties box. Here you go, Bob Meldrum. What the big boys eat. He didn't ask for anything in the box, and that's exactly what you got. What Margie Sheff of Merrick, New York would like to get is weekends and holidays with no sports on television. Dick Enberg and Merlin Olsen, look out. And all sportscasters who brag too much about athletes should watch out for John Crane of Green Valley, Arizona. He wants to give them the cut sign, literally. Jill Kerbis of DeKalb, Illinois, only wants to cut the Bears' Dan Hampton's hair. Suzanne Reese of Shelbyville, Kentucky, likes Hampton's teammate Gary Fensick. She wants either a vicious tackle or a dinner date. Emmeline Palmer of Fullerton, California, just wants coffee with Mr. Coffee, Joe DiMaggio. Kathy Mitzel, an Illinois football fan, will bring dessert. She wants to throw her cream pie in Michigan coach Bo Schembechler's face. On a gentler note, Pastor Bob Howard of the Rock Cut Baptist Church in Conley, Georgia, wants to play, but not on Sunday. Six-year-old David Slattery of Du Bois, Pennsylvania, would play for the Raiders anytime. He looks ready now. While a 15-year-old named Susan Burke would kill for Joe Montana. He writes, I want a picture of Joe Montana. I want to go to Joe Montana's house. I want to shop with Joe Montana's wife. I love Joe Montana. And Sue, here's an official 49ers t-shirt, personally autographed by Joe Montana. And we will be sending it out to you in your home. In where else? Troy, Montana. And here's a letter from 320-pound Murray the Whole Kitchen Kelman of Brooklyn. He wants to sit on an NBA bench. He sent us this picture of himself on his favorite bench. And then there's 13-year-old Mickey DuVall's letter from Russellville, Arkansas, to announce a University of Arkansas basketball game. He's the only one who asked. So off we go to Fayetteville.
Hello, everyone. This is Mike Neal, the radio voice of the Arkansas Razorback basketball team. And with me is Mickey DuVall of Russellville, Arkansas, whose sports fantasy it is to do play-by-play for the Razorbacks. He will do that tonight when Arkansas meets the University of Houston Cougars at Barnhill Arena in Fayetteville. And Mickey, of all the fantasies, of all the things you could have done, why choose Razorback basketball?
Well, I've always liked the basketball team of the Razorbacks, and I've always envied you in doing the play-by-play on radio.
It certainly has been fun. Let me ask you, have you done your homework? Are you ready to do a great job tonight?
I've done my homework, and hopefully I'll do the job tonight.
First half action. Arkansas trails Houston by 6. It's Mickey DuVall's debut.
Cross-court pass to Irvin, quickly to Carpenter. Carpenter, hook shot hits.
Holy smokes, that's the first time he's taken and hit a hook shot all year. He was ready to hit it.
23-23, off to Smith.
He took his Razorbacks from 6 points down, and he got them back even. So, Mickey, this cheers for you. Go back to our studios in New York.
Bill McAtee back now at Studio 6A in New York, and we'll have more sports fantasy in just a few moments. But at one time or another, it has been every baseball player's fantasy from Little League on to be blessed with a kind of talent and achieve the fame of the immortal Babe Ruth. In fact, in George Herman's case, Babe is all that's necessary to identify the legend. And he's the subject of our Years Ago Today.
The passage of sports time. The moments are brief, but the memories are lasting. Today, we remember one of these moments, and it's brought to you by The Prudential, offering a full range of financial services.
Years ago today, Babe Ruth becomes the highest paid baseball player in history by signing with the Yankees for $70,000 a season. George Herman Ruth is as identifiable today as he was in his prime, and the legend's name may well outlive the game itself. Babe Ruth became a national figure. Good times were the moments he lived for, and his fans approved. An entire nation loved him, and the youngsters made him their personal hero.
I'm telling you, wherever Babe went, he was idolized by everybody, and the kids, even when we went to Japan in 1934, he'd walk down the street and there'd be two or 3,000 people followed him, and things like that, but he was such a great guy.
On and off the field, the Babe was carefree and uncontrollable, tailor-made for that era. In 1914, he joins the Boston Red Sox, where he sets a World Series record by pitching 29 consecutive scoreless innings. In 1919, Ruth was acquired by the Yankees, where he became the driving force behind that baseball dynasty. In his first 2 years as a full-time player, the Sultan of SWAT astonished the baseball world by hitting 54 and 59 home runs. In 1927, the Bambino became the highest-paid baseball player in history and proceeded to prove his worth by hitting 60 home runs. His most dramatic moment occurred in the 1932 World Series against the Cubs before a hostile Wrigley Field crowd.
Well, I stepped out of the box, and by that time, they were over there going crazy. And I looked out at center field, and I pointed. I said, I'm going to hit the next pitch ball right past the flagpole. Well, the good Lord must have been with me.
On June 13th, 1948, the Babe arrives at Yankee Stadium for his last appearance. It was here, in the house that Ruth built, that Babe Ruth witnessed his final tribute and answered in a dying voice.
Many lovely things said about me, and I'm glad that I've had the opportunity to thank you.
Powerful new financial help is coming. The Rock.
It's one of the more common fantasies to be standing in goal and one of the greatest players of all time is bearing down on you on a breakaway. We received hundreds of requests from viewers who wanted to try to stop Wayne Gretzky, the greatest scorer playing today. But there's an irony in that. It just may be that Gretzky's fantasy is to score that goal.
Number 99 for the Stanley Cup champions, Wayne Gretzky. Simply spectacular. But the great one has been awarded 4 penalty shots in his career, and he scored just one. And his percentage on breakaways isn't much better. What's more, our viewer, Steve Moline from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, has more than that going for him. He might have some divine help. He's a Lutheran pastor. His church? Our saviors, of course. So we brought him from his local rink in Sioux Falls to the Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton, where the voice of the Oilers, Rod Phillips, checked his vital signs.
Steve, you seem to be a relatively sane man. Why would you want to do something like this?
Well, he's the best, and I've also just felt that he's a credit to hockey. He's a gentleman, and it'd be fun to just be on the ice with such a person.
Do you have any kind of experience at this work?
Played high school hockey in St. Paul, Minnesota, as a goaltender, but no hockey experience other than that.
Do you have a family?
Yes, have a wife, Marcia, and two children, Kyle and Kindy. They're sharing in the excitement as well.
All right. Have you asked for any advice from anybody?
Other than God?
Yes.
Haven't asked for it, but has received quite a bit of advice.
And then, wouldn't you know it, our pastor got a break. Oilers goaltender Grant Fuhr was late for team practice. He had a good excuse. His wife was giving birth. So Reverend Moline stepped into goal and got warmed up by the entire team.
Good. Fun.
Instead of you taking the shot, why don't we get one of the players that are good at scoring goals take it?
Believe me, I'd love to give... I think we should let Cement take the shot, but since he's got a sore hand, this is it. You're down to me. I'm the only guy.
Well, you know, there's a lot at stake in the shot. If you don't score on this guy, the Vatican is probably going to start their own team and try to knock us off.
I have trouble enough against the goalies, never mind having to shoot against God. I'm definitely in big trouble this time.
Well, give it your best shot.
All right. Okay, here we go.
And now, under the Stanley Cup banners, the pastor from Our Savior's Church, and Gretzky goes to his knees, either seeking forgiveness or the strength to actually score one.
How am I supposed to score against God?
Here's Gretzky in across the blue line, moving in on goal. He shoots, he scores!
Yes. Even I get lucky on breakaways.
Here's Gretzky back at the blue line.
Here we go, another shot.
Getting set, he shoots, and he scores again.
Win for deep, he's shooting. Come on, Steve.
Now Gretzky back at center ice, going in on goal. Here's Gretzky. Will he shoot? Will he deep? He stops, sets up, trying to work right in, and Moline trying to check him. Moline down. Here's Gretzky waiting. What will he do? And he makes the save. He finally poke checks the great Gretzky.
That was fun. Good job.
Thank you.
I was waiting for you to deke and you shot both times. That was good. Not very hard, however. Thanks.
Still to come, Arnie's Army versus Phil's Fleet. We invited viewers to write to us. We expected lots of mail about baseball and football, and we got it. But one sport that ran right up there was golf. Thousands wrote that they'd love to challenge their favorite golfers, Palmer, Nicklaus, Trevino. Could we please get one of them? Well, we did. But before we get to fantasy golf, let's go to the real golf world. The Honda Classic follows Sports World in Carl Springs, Florida today, so let's get an update.
Talk about living out a fantasy. How would you like to be 29-year-old, virtually unknown Kenny Knox, chipping in on the third hole to get to even par? The same 29-year-old Kenny Knox, who has never won on the tour and has qualified three times. He is leading at 1-under, chased by Mahaffey, Rose, and Bean, along with Jekyll and Mudd, also in the hunt. But the story is Kenny Knox. Now let's go back to Sports World.
And now to fantasy golf. A California lab equipment salesman takes on Arnold Palmer. It's one hole, sudden death. Arnold Palmer, a living legend. And he's no stranger to pressure putts. This one at the 83 Skins game netted him $100,000. But today, he has to do it against a California salesman.
NBC Sports is in the Palm Springs desert area for a remarkable sports story. Here at the Ironwood Country Club, golfing great Arnold Palmer and a young man named Phil Taylor have played through 18 holes all even. They're getting set for sudden death, or sudden victory in this case. Let's meet the players and get set for the action. Here's former Masters champion, Bob Golby.
Thanks, Jay. Phil, you just played 18 holes with the greatest player in the world. You're tied after 18 holes. Fantastic. How do you feel?
A little nervous, but it's an honor to be playing with Arnie today, Bob. And it's sudden death. Got another hole to play or so. we'll see what happens. I'm ready to play.
Arnie, it's nip and tuck, isn't it?
He's tough, Bob. You know, I'm a little nervous myself about this whole situation. I'm going to be concentrating pretty heavy here this hole.
So we're set for sudden death. It's a par 4, 380 yards. And Arnold Palmer is set.
There's a good solid drive starting down the right side, starting to draw a little bit, and it's just in the right side of the fairway. Beautiful shot by Arnold.
Arnold Palmer's played all over the world, and Arnie's army has followed him. How about this? Here's Phil's fleet. He's got his group of rooters here this afternoon as he challenges one of the great players in the world.
We start down the left side, hit it a little bit in the heel, a little high, but it's going to be in play.
My guess.
Bob, they're set for their second shots, and I noticed Taylor was talking with his caddy down there.
Get it up over that tree a little bit.
You gotta get some loft.
Things up front, it's a two-tier green. You don't want to be coming down that hill.
And you've got the wind behind us to put it from.
It's in a wedge.
They've been discussing the distance. They're looking at the 150-yard bush. I think it's going to play 122 yards to the flag. Difficult shot because the green is elevated, and he's chosen a sand wedge, and he's going to have to really bust this thing to get to that flag. He's hit it a little thin, but it might be good because it's going to hit short of the green and get a good skip. Boy, it's a nice shot, Jay.
It is. He's got it in very excellent shape. An opportunity for a birdie three. Arnold Palmer, his second shot from the right side, about 98 yards out.
Looks pretty short, but I'll take the pitching right.
Good-looking shot. Might be a little bit strong, Jay. Right in line with the flag.
It's come back of the flag about 15, 16 feet away.
Phil, what'd you do that? Did you catch that little... I saw you.
Got a little bit.
Got it on the backside.
Yeah. I got it caught in the grass on the takeaway, and I should have stopped, and I didn't.
Well, it worked out all right.
We don't have any...
Arnold Palmer putting for the birdie. Downhill from about 16 feet.
Oh, I left it short. Is that good?
That's good to me.
Thank you.
All right.
Now here's the opportunity. Phil Taylor putting for the birdie and the victory over Arnold Palmer. Bingo, he's got it. Birdie three for Taylor and the championship.
Well, congratulations, Phil. Hey, that's all right. Very good.
Phil, nice going.
Thank you very much.
That was great. Arnie, I didn't think he could do it.
Hey, listen, he knocked that thing in like he was right out here on the tour all the time.
Those young nerves.
Yeah, that's the truth.
Great, Phil.
Up. Morgana. Super Bowl, World Series, Olympics. But sometimes big dreams take another form. Not necessarily competition, but definitely one-on-one. For example, Mike Aiden is a coal miner who wrote from Divernon, Illinois. He's a mine foreman. Some viewers write to us that they want to catch the winning touchdown in the Super Bowl. Other viewers want to hit the winning home run in the World Series. You want to do what?
I want to be a pitcher in a ball game, and Morgana come out and give me a big kiss.
Why that kind of fantasy?
I've watched her over the years, ever since she started, and that's just what I want to do.
Do the guys down in the mine think you're nuts?
Yeah.
Morgana, the kissing bandit. For 15 years, she has been interrupting baseball games with her own special brand of seventh-inning stretch.
Her sneak attacks have ranged from the All-Star game in Cleveland 5 years ago when she got Len Barker to a controversial performance in the Astrodome last season when she kissed Nolan Ryan.
Why do you do what you do?
Well, I don't deserve a lot of credit for it. At least I didn't in the beginning, because it started on a double dirty dare that I ran out and first kissed Pete Rose. Now, that was 18 Major League Baseball players, two football coaches, a professional basketball player, and the San Diego Chicken ago. Now, I guess I do deserve credit, because it's a real challenge now trying to outrun the police and then, you know, jump the fence, take off my disguise that I have to wear to even get into a stadium to watch the games anymore.
It is a challenge. In Houston, she was arrested and charged with trespassing. The charges were dropped, but not before her lawyer had concocted a unique defense.
The gravity defense, which I think was a first, unheard of. He said the gravity defense was the fact that I have a 112-pound body and a 15-pound chest, and all I was doing was leaning over to watch where the foul ball was going, and just gravity took its toll.
Morgana lives in Columbus, Ohio, so we brought our coal miner to Cooper Stadium, the home of the Columbus Clippers. We dressed Mike Eden in a Clippers uniform and sent him out to the mound to fulfill his fantasy.
Thanks, Morgana. Our next edition of Sports World Sports Fantasy will be in August. If